Rights and defenses. The effect of registration of a trademark is that it gives the trademark holder the right to initiate a infringement suit. And the trademark holder also has rights, exclusive rights in relation to goods and services for which it is granted, which means any other person who uses a mark which is identical or similar with regard to the goods and services owned by the trademark holder can now amount to an infringement. And in case of an infringement, the trademark holder can initiate action to stop the person from continuing the infringement. Now, this is subject to certain conditions and limitations imposed by the trademark office. Registration is regarded as prima facie evidence of validity. Infringement suit with regard to a registered trademark can be filed at the place where the trademark holder resides. An infringement suit has to demonstrate that the fact there has been infringement. Now, this can be done when a registered trademark is infringed by a person who, not being the registered proprietor, uses in the course of trade a mark which, because of its identity with the registered mark or similarity of the goods and services, or because of the similarity with the registered mark and identity or similarity of goods or services, or its identity with the registered mark and identity of goods and services covered by the mark, is likely to cause confusion on the part of the public, or which is likely to have an association with the registered trademark. So these are the three instances. One, its identity with the registered trademark and similarity with the goods and services covered is likely to cause confusion. Its similarity with the registered trademarks and the identity or similarity of the goods and services covered by such trademark is likely to cause confusion. Or the identity with the registered trademark and the identity of the goods and services covered by the trademark is likely to cause confusion. So what this essentially means is that where a mark that is used by a person is said to be infringing, if it is identical or similar either to the registered mark or identical or similar to the goods and services that have been covered by the registered mark. So there is identity to the registered mark or similarity to the registered mark. There is identity with the registered mark or identity with the goods and services. Now, this identity or similarity should result in confusion. It is of such a nature that it is likely to cause confusion. So infringement is proved if there is a likelihood of confusion, and the confusion can arise with regard to identity or similarity, either with regard to the mark or with regard to the goods and services. With regard to the third condition, that its identity with the registered mark and the identity of the goods or services covered by such registered mark is likely to cause confusion, the court shall presume that it is likely to cause confusion on the part of the public. So with regard to the third point, there is a presumption of confusion. There can also be infringement through advertisements. A registered trademark is infringed by any advertising of that trademark if such advertising, one, takes unfair advantage of or is contrary to honest practices in industrial and commercial matters, or two, is detrimental to its distinctive character, or three, is against the reputation of the trademark. So any advertisement that is against the reputation of a trademark, is detrimental to its distinctive character, or takes unfair advantage can amount to infringement. So any unauthorized use of the trademark on packaging goods for sale, import, export, etc. will amount to infringement. So unauthorized use amounts to infringement. Disparaging advertisement, as we just saw, where the reputation of the mark or the distinctiveness of the mark or an unfair advantage is made, which is against honest practices in industrial and commercial matters, would also amount to infringement. There's a distinction between a disparaging advertisement and a comparative advertisement. Comparative advertisements are normally allowed, but disparaging advertisements are not allowed. An unregistered trademark can be protected by the relief of passing off. And for proving passing off, the claimant, a person who initiates the action, has to show that he has goodwill in the mark and that the defendant had misrepresented that, and such misrepresentation is likely to deceive the public, and the misrepresentation deceives the goodwill of the claimant. So there are three things. The claimant has to demonstrate goodwill. Claimant has to show that there has been a misrepresentation by the defendant, which is likely to deceive the public. And the misrepresentation harms the goodwill of the claimant. If these three conditions are satisfied, then an action of passing off can be initiated against a user who uses the trademark without consent. Passing off is generally used with regard to trademarks that are not registered. Unregistered trademarks can be protected by way of a passing off. For this, goodwill is necessary, and the claimant has to demonstrate goodwill and also show there has been harm because of the misrepresentation to the goodwill. Cybersquatting, as we have already seen, is where domain names are registered by a person other than the owner of the trademark. And these practices are regarded as abusive and in bad faith. And there is a mechanism, as we have seen, ICANN, Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers, has a policy and a dispute settlement and a dispute settlement mechanism to resolve disputes. And the policy clearly states that a person who registers a domain name will be subject to the dispute resolution policy. Exploitation and use of trademarks. Trademarks are generally self-exploited. They can be, if they are not self-exploited, they can be assigned, and licenses can also be given around them. They can be mortgages on trademark, but they cannot be a compulsory license, unlike copyright and patents. They cannot be a compulsory license in relation to trademarks, and this was prohibited by the TRIPS agreement. Defenses. In case of an infringement suit, if there is a conflict between registered trademarks, that will not amount to infringement. There are two concurrent registrations for the same or similar mark, and the registration happens with regard to same goods and services. Now, if both the registrations exist, then it cannot amount to an infringement. There could be an action of passing off based on the entity or the party who is able to demonstrate goodwill will succeed in an action for passing off. If the use by an unauthorized user is legitimate, again, that can be a ground for a defense. For instance, a honest concurrent use can be a defense in an infringement action. If the use by an unauthorized user indicates the characteristic of the product or the surface, that will not amount to infringement, and that can be a defense in an infringement suit. So, though there is a mark covering a characteristic of the product or a service, then the mark will not be enforceable because any other person using the product or the service will have to describe the characteristics. Now, we found this as one of the grounds, the fact that it explains the kind, quality, quantity, character of the product or services shall not be a ground for granting a registration. In fact, it shall be a relative ground for denying registration. Use of the mark outside the scope of registration can be a defense. So the registration is for particular classes. For instance, a mark is covered for food, but it is not covered for hospitality. So you could still use the mark in a different class. Descriptive use. Marks which are descriptive of the product or service If another person uses the mark, which again describes the use, then that will be a defense in an infringement suit because the mark describes the product or the service. Use of name or address, which describes the product or which denotes the product or identifies the product, again can be a defense. Comparative advertisement that we have already mentioned, and as we had seen in the case of the frozen desserts case study, that was a case of comparative advertisement, though HUL Hindustan Unilever Limited had alleged that it amount to disparaging advertisement. Now, in a disparaging advertisement, there has to be a direct comparison to the product, and the three things: it should be an unfair practice, not recognized by the trade, they should be harm to the reputation, and they should be harm to the distinctive nature of the trademark. If these three things are there, then it amounts to a disparaging advertisement. Otherwise, it just amounts to a comparative advertisement. Again, if the use is by the consent of the trademark holder, that will be a defense in an infringement suit. The mark has to be constantly renewed and it has to be protected from unauthorized use. Marks can lose their protection if they are abandoned. By not using the mark can amount to have been abandoned. And if there is a change in the product or service than for which it is registered. So you register a mark for a particular class and use it in a different class, then that could be another reason why the law will treat the mark as being abandoned. You may lose protection on a mark when a mark becomes generic. A word now has been used, which is traditionally a mark. A word which is originally a mark has now been used commonly in trade. And this could be a reason why a mark could lose its protection. When the mark becomes descriptive of the good, then it could amount to misleading the public, and again the mark can lose protection.